Greetings and welcome. It is so wonderful to see so many participants gathered to celebrate the work of the Feed the Future Innovation Labs and their partners. My name is Marie Boyd. I'm an associate professor at the University of South Carolina School of Law and a member of the Board for International Food and Agricultural Development, or BIFAD. Today, you'll also hear from BIFAD Chair Lawrence Alexander and member Henri Moore. The Feed the Future Innovation Labs are central to advancing novel solutions to support the shared goals of reducing global hunger, poverty, and undernutrition. I'm delighted that today's program is hosted in collaboration with the Feed the Future Innovation Lab Council of Directors, the Feed for Future Innovation Lab for Integrated Pest Management at Virginia Tech, the Feed for Future Innovation Lab for Security Policy, Research Capacity, and Influence at Michigan State University, and AgriLinks. I'd like to invite the participants today to introduce yourselves in the chat. After the presentation, if you have any questions, please use the Q&A box for those. I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Lawrence Alexander, BIFAD Chair and Chancellor of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, to share welcome remarks. Lawrence.
Thank you, Marie. On behalf of BIFAD, welcome to all participants, speakers, and to the guests of honor, the 2021 BIFAD Award recipients. I'm honored to serve as chair of BIFAD. BIFAD is a 7-member presidentially appointed advisory board to USAID established in 1975 under Title 12 of the Foreign Assistance Act. We have the mandate to advise the agency to ensure that USAID brings the assets of US universities to bear on development challenges in agriculture, nutrition, and food security. We know that our shared goals of global food security, nutrition, and resilience are more urgent than ever, as gains are challenged by the pandemic, climate crisis, conflicts, lack of equity, and other challenges. The Feed the Future Innovation Labs are critical to the innovation partnership and evidence-based programming needed to achieve the 3 overarching objectives of the Global Food Security Strategy: inclusive and sustainable agriculture-led economic growth, strengthened resilience among people, communities, countries, and systems, a well-nourished population, especially among women and children. The Feed the Future Innovation Labs are leading implementers of the Global Food Security Research Strategy, which outlines the US government's science-based and inclusive approach to addressing food security challenges spanning the biophysical, socioeconomic, and behavioral sciences. Key to this research are the partnerships among US universities and national research and extension systems, civil society, the private sector, and nonprofit organizations. We are thankful for the work of the Innovation Labs, and we value BIFAD's collaboration with the labs and with the Council of Directors, led by Dr. Aaron McGuire. The BIFAD Awards program is one way that we collaborate to recognize outstanding research to advance global food security. Now I'm pleased to introduce Aaron McGuire to share her remarks. Aaron is the Associate Director of the Horticulture Innovation Lab at the University of California at Davis and Chair of the Council of Feed the Future Innovation Lab Directors. Aaron?
Hello. Thank you, Professor Boyd and Chair Alexander. Good morning, good evening, and namaste for those joining from Nepal. I'm honored to be here today as the chair of the Feed the Future Council and join my colleagues from Michigan State University and Virginia Tech to recognize research excellence for impact and help present the 2021 BIFAD Awards for Scientific Excellence in a Feed the Future Innovation Lab. Today, I'll give an overview of the Innovation Labs and our strategy and contributions to USAID and Sustainable Development Goals. I hope this overview provides a window into the importance of research in improving the lives of some of the most underserved global communities and showcases just how exceptional the work of Dr. Tom Jane and Dr. Sujana Maharjan is to be highlighted among many exceptional researchers. Feed the Future Innovation Labs leverage US-based expertise to engage with scientific and implementing networks globally. There are 21 different labs based at US universities and one in Kenya that focuses on critical crops such as groundnuts, legumes, and horticulture, and all aspects of the agriculture value chain, such as post-harvest, sustainability, and pest management. In each of our labs, we not only take on the important biophysical questions, but also social questions around policy, economics, and equity. In this highly skilled network, we use existing knowledge and create new knowledge to solve food and agricultural systems challenges, leading to improved livelihoods of farmers and communities everywhere. We do this through building the next generation of scientists, both in the United States, but also in each of the countries that we work. We build long-term resilience through these enhanced academic and innovation networks. With our partners, we tackle the challenges of today while helping to put in place the tools to tackle the challenges and embrace opportunities of tomorrow. Feed the Future Innovation Lab researchers and partners contribute critical new knowledge to advance their fields. And through our important collaborations with National Agriculture Research Services, universities, community-based organizations, we are able to identify the most pressing challenges and the most appropriate solutions. Beyond the application of this research, the labs contribute over 100 academic publications on average per award. The labs are also excellent and also an excellent investment. A recent study showed that the direct return on investment for the labs can be as high as 8 to 1. Much of the lab success rate rests on the collaborations that have been built over time. We work in over 43 countries with often many partners in each country. We not only partner with higher learning institutes, but also CGIAR centers, government ministries, and extension implementing partners, and not-for-profit entities. Under USAID's guidance, the labs are also making great strides in putting the power of leadership into the hands of many of these in-country partners. At home, we are incorporating more and more minority-serving institutions into Feed the Future programming. By ensuring a diverse and representative pipeline of innovation, we are more likely to meet the dynamic and heterogeneous global challenges we face. So this is just a visual representation of our partner network in the US. And this gets even more complicated as you expand to global partnerships. As you can see, the 21 labs based at the lead universities only represent a small portion of the entourage of universities engaged in global problem solving through the Feed the Future network. Briefly, I want to highlight some of the collective goals the labs are working toward. Resilience. We work toward this through research-based solutions, such as understanding how to mitigate and adapt to climate change. As we know, the majority of the globe's farmers will need a suite of adaptation tools to survive extreme weather changes. We also structurally work toward resilience by supporting a new generation of researchers and experts. Each lab has its own contribution to make toward nutrition. We know that stunting is a generational burden, and without addressing it, we are continuing a cycle of poverty. Here's an example from Ethiopia on how increasing diet diversity is correlated with a reduction in stunting. This takes the work of each lab, moving toward a systems approach to better nutrition for all. Finally, as we strive toward resilient, sustainable production and gender equity, we must consider who our innovations will benefit and who they may harm. This involves taking into account different cultural landscapes and specific challenges and opportunities for certain groups of people. Research done by the Feed the Future Labs is key to improving lives globally. It is from this robust group of academics that I can congratulate two of the researchers doing this essential work. I also am grateful to BIFAD, the chair, and its members, and all of you on the call today for the opportunity to work together and recognizing these important contributions. Congratulations again to Dr. Sarjina Maharjan and Dr. Tom Jane. Back to you, Marie.
Thank you. And now to announce the 2021 award recipients, I'm pleased to introduce my colleague, Ms. Henri Moore. Henri is Vice President, Head of Responsible Business at Haleon Health, and was appointed by President Biden to BIFAD in January 2022. Henri is championing the board's commitment to an awards program that fosters inclusive innovation. She has great passion for inspiring students and early career researchers. Henri, welcome.
Thanks, Marie. And to Lawrence and Aaron, thank you for your remarks. So this is the thing that we've been waiting for. We are here to honor two researchers for their outstanding contributions to research that will impact global food security, agriculture, and nutrition. So when I first started my role, this was one of the first things I was able to do. And so it was very exciting to be able to chair the panel to really go through all this research with this esteemed panel of people. And, you know, as I was reading through it, it just kind of blew me away, the work that is being done out in the world today. So it was just such an honor to be a part of it. The BIFAD Awards for Scientific Excellence recognizes research efforts that contribute to the interrelated and interdependent objectives of the global food security strategy. The inclusive and sustainable agriculture-led economic growth strengthened resilience among people and systems, and the I have been on the road now for quite a few days, going from the East Coast to the West Coast, back to the East Coast in the last 2 days. So I'm a little tongue-tied this morning, but BIFAD also annually recognizes one senior researcher or research team, and then one student. And the 2021 nominations were submitted in August 2021, and we convened the panel on May 3rd. So it was a very exciting time. We had open nominations. We released them in the spring. The nominations came in, and we reviewed them as a panel. And on the panel was Dr. Jemima Njuki. She was the Chief of Economic Empowerment Section at UN for Women. Dr. Moses Cairo, who is the Dean and Professor in the School of Ag and Natural Science at the University of Maryland Eastern Shore. And Dr. Negeste Gize, who is Director of International Foundation for Science. And so with the esteemed panel, we carried out and looked at the criteria, which was demonstrated scientific and technical merit, demonstrated relevance to developing country, national, and regional agricultural research priorities, demonstration of impact and potential to have broader impact at scale, and last, evidence of commitment to integrating inclusive development and local capacity development. So those were our criteria, and we looked at this many impressive nominations that came in and decided on the two recipients here today. So for the 2021 Senior Research and Research Team, the panel selected Dr. Thomas Jane of Michigan State. He is the University Foundation Professor of Agricultural, Food, and Resource Economics at Michigan State. And Dr. Jane is widely recognized for his exemplary economic and policy research on food systems transformation in Africa with the Feed the Future Innovation Lab for Food Security Policy Research, Capacity, and Influence, the Feed the Future Innovation Lab for Policy, and the Feed the Future Innovation Lab for Collaborative Research on Sustainable Intensification. So we would like to congratulate Dr. Jane for this great accomplishment. The BIFAD and the awards panel are especially excited to recognize the student and early career researchers through the awards programs, as students really represent our future with the growing challenges we have in food, agriculture, and nutrition. So for the 2021 Student Research Award, the panel selected Dr. Surjana Marhajan, doctoral student at Tribhuvan University in Nepal. Dr. Marhajan is being recognized for her excellent research contributions as a PhD student to the Feed the Future Innovation Lab for Integrated Pest Management with focus on the ecology and biological control of an invasive weed species in central Nepal. So congratulations, Dr. Marhajan, for that accomplishment. So we are now going to hear directly from the 2021 award recipients, and I'd like to hand it back to Marie to introduce the speakers. Thanks, Marie.
Thanks, Henri, for your leadership as chair of the awards panel. Now, to introduce the 2021 Senior Researcher Award recipient, I welcome Dr. Adesoji O. Adeloja, John A. Hanna, Distinguished Professor in Land Policy, Department of Agricultural, Food, and Resource Economics at Michigan State University. Dr. Elijah.
Thank you, Marie. It is my honor to introduce my friend and colleague, Dr. Thomas Jane, the 2021 recipient of the BIFAD Senior Research Award. I think this special award recognizes those very rare individuals whose research efforts have been pivotal in achieving the strategic objectives of the US government's Global Food Security Strategy. My co-nominator is Felicia Wu, and we nominated Tom on behalf of the Department of Agriculture, Food and Resource Economics at Michigan State University. She apologizes for not being able to join us today. She's also a John A. Hanna Distinguished Professor at Michigan State University. We nominated Tom for four reasons. Number one, he has been a long-term icon of development work at Michigan State University. He stands out. Number two, he's held in very high esteem in the academic and policy communities, not only in the United States, in Africa, and indeed worldwide. Number three, the impact of his work is unparalleled. And number four, he exemplifies what this BIFAD Excellence Award was designed to recognize. I might remind you that Tom Jane is the university, or the Emeritus University Distinguished Professor at Michigan State University, but recently and currently, he also serves as Special Advisor to the President of the African Development Bank. In addition to that, he serves on the board of the Regional Network for Agricultural Policy Research Institutes, RENAPRI, an important network which he worked very hard to build in Africa. I might also mention that Tom is a fellow of the American Agricultural Economics Association, which is the highest recognition by the premier professional body of agricultural and applied economists. Specifically, why is Tom being recognized today? I don't want to get into the specific areas of his work or indicate the specific innovation labs that he has contributed to, for those things have been already discussed. I'm just going to get to his unique traits as a scholar. First, he's a frontiersman, a pacesetter, a visionary, and creative thinker in the area of development policy research in Africa. He has an uncanny ability to identify, quantify, and analyze emerging new issues in ways that redefine the research agenda and shape decisive outcomes. Second, he's prolific and intellectually rigorous. His publications have strong interdisciplinary appeal, are widely quoted in mainstream media, and are utilized extensively in policy discourse. For example, in his career, he has had approximately 130 peer-reviewed journal articles in leading journals, over six special issues of journals or books, dozens of insightful reports, blogs, or policy briefs. And as I mentioned earlier, he's also an AAEA fellow and the recipient of the Bruce Gardner Memorial Prize for Policy Analysis. The third reason, of course, is that Tom is widely respected as a thought leader with a commitment to institutional capacity building and impact-oriented policy programs. Tom recognizes that development work is about empowering the ultimate beneficiaries, be they poor farmers in Africa, researchers globally, or policymakers in Africa, in the US, or the world. He operates very effectively at that last mile where the rubber meets the road by helping to build capacity of people and institutions so they may not need him perpetually. As you can see, Tom exemplifies the 21st century land grant scholar driving innovative research, strategic engagement, and meaningful impact by design. Whether it's his work on sustainable intensification, the rapid rise of medium-scale entrepreneurial African farms, the process of agricultural transformation, he pursues his work with genuine aplomb and a deep commitment to making a difference. Please join me in welcoming Professor Thomas S. Jane to give a short presentation and receive his award. Tom?
Wow, well, thank you, Soji, you make me blush. It's such an honor to receive this award. I'm really grateful to everyone involved in this. I'd also like to congratulate my colleague Sirjana for joining me today in receiving this award. So thank you so much. So in the 12 minutes that I have, I would like to just touch briefly on a few selected insights that were made possible from the Feed the Future Innovation Labs. And I would like to acknowledge, first of all, BIFAD for their unwavering support to university-led research in informing international food and ag development issues. I'd also like to recognize my colleagues at USAID who, for their longstanding commitment to supporting and improving livelihoods through these Feed the Future Innovation Labs. I'd also like to thank my colleagues at MSU and the broader university community for leading and managing these innovation labs. I've been involved in three of them over the past decade or so. One of them is the Food Security Policy Innovation Lab that was led by Maiwish Meridia and Duncan Boughton, thanks to them. I'd also really enjoyed my interaction with the Kansas State University Sustainable Intensification Lab. Vera Prasad was leading that. Learned a lot of agronomy in that in that grant. And then the third, the one I'm currently still involved in, even in an emeritus capacity, is the Policy Research Capacity and Influence (PRCI) Innovation Lab that's being led by Dave Shirley. All my other colleagues at MSU, some of who I see are on the, who have joined, it's been wonderful working together with you. And then lastly, my African colleagues, basically in the 35 years that I've been working here, I've been involved from the get-go with African researchers and policymakers, and that's really made it all fun and rewarding and impactful. So hats off to my colleagues in Africa. Okay, so and very quickly, I'm gonna touch on three themes that we've all been involved in over the past decade. The first one is, what is sustainable intensification? And what does sustainable intensification look like in rural Africa, many parts of which are becoming densely populated, where land constraints are really limiting the potential for area expansion. So that's number one. Number two is this really interesting rise in this commercial class of African farmers, medium-scale farms, and the kind of transformational impacts that they're having in Africa. And then the third issue that I'd like to focus on, or just touch on rather, is the importance of institutional capacity development of policy research institutes in Africa, and why that's important for our success, USAID, as well as BIFAD, in promoting improved livelihoods in Africa. Okay, so theme number one, sustainable intensification. So historically, Africa has increased its production almost entirely from area expansion. There's been little progress in improving yields on existing farmland. While Africa contains roughly 60% of the world's remaining arable land, 90% of this is in 9 countries. So if you take the first two here, DRC Congo and Angola, you see that those two countries account for 56.9% of all of the remaining non-forested arable land in Africa. And the top 9 countries of Africa account for over 90% of Africa's unutilized arable land, meaning that in the other 45 African countries, there really is very limited potential to rely on area expansion, the historical approach of improving agricultural production in Africa. There's very little potential for relying on that as the way forward. So another fact that I think is just very interesting, thinking of the implications of this, is that rural Africa, 10% of its rural areas contain about 3/4 of all of its rural people. So these areas are highly concentrated population-wise into places that, you know, are generally highland areas with fertile soils. So this is where really the action is in agriculture, smallholder agriculture in Africa. But from the standpoint of smallholder agriculture, there's very limited potential for continued reliance on area expansion, meaning that we really need to focus on sustainable systems for improving yields on existing farmland. And this requires technical innovation and I would say much greater attention to soil health and sustainable land management practices. Now, where do those sustainable land management practices come from? They can only really come from adaptive agricultural R&D, research development, crop science, agronomy, and extension systems that link scientists together with farmers. So many donors have been reluctant to really wade into this area of supporting adaptive African-led R&D institutes and extension systems. And indeed, many African governments have underfunded these institutions as well. But they really need to be part of a sustainable food security strategy moving forward. Okay, theme number two is this rise of commercialized farmers. So you all remember about 15 years ago when world food prices shot up rapidly, and this, you know, created this global scramble for land, and you all remember the discussions about foreign land grabs happening a lot in Africa. But under the radar, there was this massive acquisition of land occurring by relatively wealthy Africans as well. And, you know, in fact, they really dwarfed the amount of land that the foreign investors were getting. And, you know, having sort of just very, very profound impacts on the whole nature of agricultural transformation in Africa. The rise of medium-scale farms in Africa, if you put together the micro data from all the countries that we were able to do, you see that some of them, like Ghana and Tanzania, have had these rapid increases in the share of production and the share of marketed output that's supplied by these medium scale farms. So they're really having a big impact, not always. You know, they're increasing land prices, they're contributing to land scarcity, and there's a lot of distributional effects that need to be teased out further. Now, the third theme that I'd like to focus on has to do with capacity development. And, you know, there's just a major difference in the landscape today compared to 25 years ago in terms of the number of well-qualified African analysts that are out there. The 1980s model of having international research groups leading and guiding and agricultural policy discussions may need to be modified. It may not be as effective today as it was before. Some research that we've conducted shows that there's a greater probability that there'll be actual impact, policy impact, when local African-led national policy units are really leading the discussion and bringing in international researchers in a support role. So this really does have implications for international universities, the CG system, et cetera, in playing a role that will be backing up and supportive of African-led organizations going forward. So I think that has implications for our innovation labs. The last slide, Chair, is that just some contributions that I think that we've made in these innovation labs over the last decade is, first of all, rising appreciation of the importance of soil health, how rising rural population density and land scarcity are creating greater urgency for sustainable and resilient land management practices, a heightened appreciation for strengthening national, that means African-led agricultural R&D and extension. I'm happy to see that there's been a mild explosion in the amount of research that is being done on these medium-scale farms in Africa and their impacts, much of which are still really unknown, just both direct and indirect impacts. And then the last contribution is that I think there has been greater emphasis in the recent Feed the Future Innovation Labs in emphasizing capacity development of on-the-ground policy organizations. So with those remarks, Chair, once again, I'm really grateful to be a recipient of this award. It's an honor to me. I feel a lot of gratitude from this. So thank you so much. I look forward to the rest of the discussion and to Sirjana's presentation as well. Thank you.
Congratulations, Tom. And wow, thank you for your presentation and for your commitment to inclusive research, meaningful partnerships, and locally led development. I know some of you may have questions for Tom. Please use the Q&A box in the Zoom menu to share these. And after our next presentation, we will host a brief question and answer session. And now I'm very pleased to introduce Dr. Rangaswamy Munyappan, the director of the Feed the Future Integrated Pest Management Innovation Lab, who will introduce the 2021 Student Award recipient.
Thank you, Marie, for the introduction. The IPM Innovation Lab has been operating for the last 25 years in different countries. In 2015, the IPM Innovation Lab gave a project to Dr. Pramod Kumar Jha of Tribhuvan University and Dr. Abhijit Adiga of University of Virginia to take up studies on climate change, biodiversity, and invasive species in Nepal. This team graduated 21 master students and 5 PhD students in the range of about 7 years. Dr. Sirjana Mahajan is one of the PhD students in graduated supported by this program. She studied the invasive species Parthenium histophorus, its spread, impact, and management in Nepal. Invasive species are known to cost millions of dollars in damage around the world. So her study is very important in protecting the environment of Nepal. She has also published 7 papers in international journals based on her PhD thesis. Currently, she is employed as a scientific officer at the Ministry of Forests and Environment at the in Nepal. Coming to the Parthenium weed, it is a native of the New World. In the last 50 years, it got introduced to Africa, Asia, and Australia. In 1955, it got introduced to India, and it started to spread all over India, and then it also moved to Nepal in 1967. In recent years, it has also migrated to Pakistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, and Sri Lanka from India. It is a serious weed in agricultural lands, pasture lands, range lands, parks and recreation areas, roadsides, almost everywhere where it has established. If people weed this by hand, it causes rash, and the pollen also causes respiratory problems. It also affects animals that feed on this weed. So it is a serious problem. Dr. Mahajan has done an excellent job of studying this weed in Nepal. Not only she figured out how it is spreading, how fast it is going to spread, and also how to control this weed. So it is my pleasure to invite Dr. Sirjana Mahajan to present her research work. Sirjana, please.
Thank you, Dr. Muni. Namaste to everyone. Good morning and good evening. It is a great honor for me to be a recipient of this highly prestigious award, BIFAD Student Research Award. And I'd like to thank USAID IPMIL Project, BIFAD, my supervisors, Dr. Muni, Professor Jha, and all the teachers who all supported me to keep on carrying this research and complete this my research successfully. And it's really an honor to present the highlights of my research in such a huge platform. And I'd also like to thank, congratulate Professor Thom also here in this platform. My research topic is ecology and management of invasive weed Parthenium sterophorus through biological methods in central Nepal. As we know, Parthenium sterophorus, it is one of the invasive species which is native to northern and southern America, and it has already invaded 92 countries across the globe. And it is first time reported in 2067 from Nepal. And it's already problematic in grassland, agricultural land, and the residential areas of Nepal. Its elevational distribution range is 64 to 1935 meter in Nepal. These all are the objectives of my research. Plant functional traits are the traits which are the morphological, physiological, and the phenological features which are measurable at the individual level and that indirectly influences the performance trait. I studied the various plant functional traits of this weed along two elevational gradient of the central Nepal, ranging from 60 to 1750 meter. And these are the traits that is I studied, some of the vegetative traits and some of the reproductive traits, sorry. And among these traits, specific leaf area, root to shoot ratio, seed size, and seed mass has increased with the increase in elevation. And this increase in this trait with the increase in elevation shows that the weed has adaptive mechanism towards the higher elevation, and it is still tending to move towards the higher elevation in Nepal. The Maxent model showed that the weed has the current suitable habitat of this weed has reached to the 20% here in this in current scenario. And it is moving, in the future climate change scenario in the RCP, also RCP 4.5 and 2.5 also, the weed is trying to tending to increase its suitable habitat by 10% with the change in the climate, in the future climate change scenario. Similarly, the weed is also tending to move by the 30 meter elevation in the future, in the RCP 4.5 scenario in the future. So this shows that the weed is, if the climate change keep on changing, the climate keep on changing, the weed start to, it move to the different higher elevation. The distribution range of the this weed in the when I compared the remote sensing images, the high resolution and the low resolution image of the remote sensing Landsat and the WorldView 2 images, it showed that in the past, in 1990, the distribution of the parthenium was only 0.2%. Which has now reached to 1.26% of the total area of the jar. And when I compare the distribution of this weed in small patches of the remote sensing image, which is high resolution image, WorldView 2 images, it showed that the weed has the substantial or the distribution is substantial in the small patches of the remote sensing image too. So, but when I compare the these high resolution image and the low resolution image, it showed that the accuracy is high in the high resolution image as compared to the low resolution image. For the efficacy of the leaf feeding beetle by Zygogramma, one of the biological control agent found in Nepal, it showed that I performed this experiment in two climatic regions of the Nepal, tropical and subtropical climate. And it showed that the biomass and plant height both decreased in tropical and subtropical climate. But the damage was higher in tropical climate as compared to the subtropical climate. The impact of biological control agent, another biological control agent, Poxinia, which is found here in Nepal, it also showed that I performed this experiment, I did the survey in the Kathmandu Valley of the Nepal, and it showed that Poxinia is widespread in Kathmandu Valley, and it is found all around the area of the Kathmandu, and the at many of the places there is the visible impact, but in some, at many places there is less impact, and in some places of the Kathmandu Valley the impact was very visible and very severe. So in those places where the impact was very severe and visible, in those places the biomass and seed output was reduced by 47% and 73%. To study the effect of grazing on plant community dynamics of the grassland area, I performed this experiment in the tropical region of Nepal, and it showed that the species richness of this the area is higher in those plots where there is less no parthenium, and it has species richness is less in those places where there is less more parthenium. And similarly, biomass of parthenium has decreased by 57%. I performed this experiment in 2 years, in 2017 and 2018. And in 2018, the biomass has automatically decreased by 57%. And the rank of important percentage has decreased from the first position to the fifth position. The relevance of my research is that plant functional trait study could help in answering questions related to fitness of plant And the modeling projections that I performed, it could be helpful to assist the to make the decision for preventing the invasion of this weed in an early detection and eradication strategies. The streamer sensing image studies that I used to study, it also helped to provide the quick pathway for the spatial and temporal distribution pattern of this weed. The biological control, use of this biological control in the appropriate place could be help for the effective and successful management of parthenium. And new management possibilities through the grazing control in highly invaded grassland could be one of the insights for the effective management of this weed. I'd like to acknowledge my supervisors, USAID IPMI project, and all the personnel from Nepal. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Muharjan, for the excellent presentation and congratulations on your recent graduation. We are now going to transition to a brief question and answer session. So please continue to share your questions in the Q&A box and we will get to as many questions as possible. So our first question was asked by P.V. Bahara Prasad. And the question is, many early career scholars are interested, but not sure how to engage in international activities, its importance and value. And Tom and Saranja, you both have done this and were successful. So what was your motivation and what advice do you have for others?
Vara, good morning. Nice to have you with us. I remember when I was in college, I saw this poster on a wall, just happened to go by it, and it said something to the effect of, you know, the goal of life is to leave the world a little bit better than when you came into it. And that, you know, that really really stuck with me about sort of just what the, you know, what our purpose is for being here. And I, you know, that's what motivated me really to go into academia, where, you know, there was a potential to produce research that could really guide policy. So that had always kind of been my primary motivation for getting involved in academia, not to just produce research publications, but to see how the that research could have an impact and, you know, motivated to improve livelihood somewhere. I noticed that a lot of academics, and I think they're advised to, you know, just maximize their publications, that that's kind of where the professional rewards are. And I kind of feel that that's slightly not correct, that of course it is important to, you know, for academics to produce as much research as they can, but there's an assembly line, and after the production of research, the real work really begins in how to guide policymakers towards why it's important and who needs to act upon it. And I think that's kind of one of the important parts of a land-grant university, where, you know, the mandate of us as researchers is to really engage in the real world and to kind of see through to the completion or to impact kind of the results of the research that we do. So I would, you know, I think that that has something to do, Vara, with, you know, your question. And, you know, I would just encourage researchers to pay a little bit more, just 5% more of their time to figuring out how to get impact and working with policymakers and those who work with policymakers, development partners, to kind of have that impact. Thank you.
The relevance of my resources that what I've conducted here and the I mean, the invasive species, it is increasing it is increasing day by day here in Nepal also. And in case of the Parthenium also, it is moving. When we compare it with the past and the current situation, the weed is increasing. So the relevance of my research is that it also helps to help the policymaker and decision maker to make that the it helps to enhance the early detection and the eradication of this weed as well. So this is the relevance of my research.
Thank you. It looks like we have time probably for one more question. And we have a question from Dr. Noor Sadiq, Virginia Tech. Tom, can you please talk about the role and capabilities of local universities conducting agricultural research and their collaborations with US universities? Could US public and land grant universities play a greater role and be involved in the research system strengthening?
Great, thank you for that question. And I think the answer is yes. I think we're moving in the right direction. As I said during my talk, I do feel that there is a lot greater commitment nowadays for US universities, the CG system, the innovation labs, to really regard their local partners as bona fide co-directors, co-PIs, you know, just that part of integral part of the co-creation process of the grant. And I hope that that trend, you know, continues and strengthens. So why is that so important? Well, you know, if you look at kind of the local policy analysis, you know, of the CG systems when they're involved in research, they're usually people stay there in a country for 4 years or 2 years, and then they move on and go somewhere else. And the real continuity that policymakers can kind of come to work with are the people who are working there for their professional careers in a certain country. They get to be known better. There's social capital that gets built up between policymakers and local researchers. So really, they need to carry the ball, and that goes for policy research as well as agronomic research and crop science and all the rest of it. So I think that the whole policy ecosystem to make things work more effectively would sort of put those groups at the center, and then they would be working with each other, the policy analysis groups, the crop science, the animal science groups, they work together. And then they're supported by the international research community. So this doesn't mean that the international research committee has no role. They have a really important role, but it's one that sort of is in service to and in support of and collaboration with rather than necessarily leading. That's my personal view. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the thoughtful questions. Tom and Srijana may have time to respond to a few of the remaining questions in the chat. Once again, I want to say thank you to Srijana and Tom, and congratulations again. Now I am excited to share the details of the 2022 call for nominations, which is now open and closes January 23rd. 2023. So mark your calendars. This year, BIFAD is inviting nominations for the Early Innovator Award, recognizing a student researcher, and the Global Innovator Award, open to researchers or research teams in all stages of their post-student career. BIFAD strongly encourages applications from early and mid-career researchers or research teams that include early to mid-career researchers. Successful recipients of both awards should demonstrate achievement across the following criteria: exemplary scientific merit, relevance to national and/or regional priorities, potential for impact, and evidence of commitment to integrating inclusive development and local capacity development. Award recipients will join a prestigious group of former awardees who have made tremendous impacts in advancing global food security, highlighting the important work of the Feed for Future Innovation Labs and partners globally. BIFAD asks for your leadership in identifying outstanding students and early career researchers. Student researchers are the unsung heroes in research and outreach programs and the future of our work. We challenge each innovation lab to commit to nominating at least one student researcher per lab for recognition. BIFAD also encourages host country research and private sector partners to consider submitting nominations. Anyone affiliated with a Feed the Future Innovation Lab is eligible to submit nominations, and there's no limit on the number of nominations that can be submitted from each lab. BIFAD asks for your support to broadly disseminate the call for nominations, which is linked in the chat, and to encourage your partners to submit nominations. Thank you again to Aaron, the Council of Directors, and the Feed the Future Innovation Labs for partnering with us to recognize scientific excellence. And now I welcome Lawrence back for closing reflections.
Thank you, Marie. Thank you so much. This has been a wonderful celebration. Tom and Sarjana, thank you for sharing your research and partnerships through the Feed the Future Innovation Labs. It's very, very impressive work here. Henri, Marie, thank you for championing the awards program. I have very much appreciated your commitment to recognizing students and early career researchers and your dedication to the principles of locally led development. I'd also like to thank the co-hosts of today's event, AgriLinks, the Feed the Future Innovation Lab Council of Directors, and Aaron as chair, the Integrated Pest Management Innovation Lab at Virginia Tech, the Food Security Policy Research Capacity and Innovation Influence Innovation Lab at MSU, and teams at USAID and BIFAD Support Contract for organizing this event. As today's program highlighted, innovation and research have important roles to play in achieving shared goals of food security, prosperity, and equality. The work of the Feed the Future Innovation Labs highlight not only America's innovative spirit, but importantly, the expertise and impact of the broader research community around the world. To all participants today, thank you for your contributions to this work. You have a great day.